Hi, welcome. I'm Deb Willis. I'm happy to be here to see 450 people are here to share our theme today on memoirs. We have been, we've had two wonderful sessions over the past two Wednesdays, and our last one is next week. We're engaging with many ideas, and I am just thrilled that during this difficult time where our worlds are changing because of COVID and the tragic deaths of Black people here in the US and around the world, that we're able to talk about memoir in this session. Cheryl?
Thank you, Deb, and good day, everyone, and welcome to this session of Women in Migrations. And as Deb said, we're focusing on memoir. But before we do, I'd like to tell you something about who we are and the purpose of this working group. This series is convened by the Women in Migrations Working Group, an interdisciplinary project founded in June of 2017 in Florence, Italy. The following summer, we published an edited volume, a compilation of the contributions of 42 women scholars, authors, and artists, some of whom you will hear from today. And I also want to point out that volume, Women in Migrations, Responses in Art and History, we'll be sending some information about that around in the chat so that you'll know something more about it. At the beginning, we also traveled to Abu Dhabi in 2019. But at the beginning of this year, Dr. Willis curated an important exhibition at the Maryland Institute College of Art, MICA, entitled Migrations and Meanings in Art, including the work of some of the artists participating in these series. And anticipating convenings in March of this year in Washington and in Athens in early June, we decided to transform this conversation to a series of conversations online. Needless to say, none of the conversations in person were possible. So we would like to thank the cooperation of all in our community and the support of many, including New York University, Washington, the Brandemas Center, and New York University's Office of Global Inclusion, Diversity, and Strategic Innovation, and the Ford Foundation. We, like everyone else, have adapted to Zoom. Now, the goal of the working group is to examine the role that photography, art, film, history, and literature have played in identifying and remembering the migratory experience of women globally. We seek to capture the breadth of experience in the movement of women and culture, and we include diasporas, internal displacements, the international and transnational migrations, movements of people because of climate change, geopolitical instabilities, authoritarianism, and the pressures of globalization. Women pressed into motion by crisis, to be sure, but also circumstances of kinship, community, collaboration, and opportunity. So today our focus is on memoir. And as we begin, we would like to honor the lives and legacies of all that have gone before us and whose land we presently live on in all the places we are throughout the world. I'd like to pass the baton now to one of our collaborators, Ellen Toscano. Ellen?
Thank you, Cheryl. This is a portion of what I presented in the book and in prior conferences with some additional research added in. She carried with her neither memory nor archive. Even if the migration, the deracination, nearly completely erased her birth and her heritage and eradicated any memory that young life could hold, the self remained. Her hands trembled slightly, maybe a scar of her loss, an instantiated trauma, an absence speaking. I was haunted by the gap that was left within me by the secrets of my mother and my grandmother. Maybe they weren't secrets. Maybe I just didn't know to ask the right questions. Uncanny, this memory of a past I knew nothing of. I knew very little about my grandmother. I didn't grow up with her and visited her no more than a week or so every summer. I knew my mother and she were very close. When we visited, they would close in my grandmother's room and talk for hours. All we heard were quiet, conspiratorial giggles. They were happiest in each other's company. It was by accident, or fortune, or destiny, that I learned of my grandmother's previously unknown origins. I wasn't looking, consciously anyway. But through her, I've come to understand the liberty of withholding and concealment, and the powerful self-fashioning of transitive identities. On July 18th, 1904, Father Thomas Hopkins, retired pastor of St. Mary's Catholic Church in Charleston, South Carolina, boarded the Comanche to sail to New York. Also on board was his housekeeper, Mary Hussey. The passage of both was duly noted in the Charleston Post and Courier the next day, along with other notable Charlestonians. Not listed, but with the pair was a six-year-old black child, whom Father Hopkins called Mary Godfrey, my grandmother. 1 month later, Father Hopkins died in Germany. As reported in the Charleston papers, he had been sick and had traveled to Germany for the healing springs. What Mary Hussey did in New York is unclear, as are the circumstances of her travel back to Charleston, where she died 2 months later of gastritis in the home of Father Hopkins. Mary Godfrey, however, stayed in New York. On July 20th, 1904, 2 days after the three departed from Charleston, she was surrendered to St. Benedict's Home for Destitute Colored Children in Rye, New York. The document recording her admission indicated that Mary was 6 years old, colored, born in South Carolina, and baptized. She was surrendered to St. Benedict's by Father Hopkins of St. Mary's Church. Her date of birth was unrecorded. The card names her mother as Mary F. Washington, a Catholic and deceased, but failed to name her father, noting only that he was alive and Protestant. It's not clear whether the notation Somerville refers to Father Hopkins' residence or Mary's birth, or both. Mary stayed in the home until she was 12, when children were discharged from St. Benedict's into service. The record of the home indicates that she was adopted by Mrs. Noonan in Great Barrington, Massachusetts. The 1910 census lists Mary in the household of Mrs. Noonan as the 15-year-old colored servant. The next records of Mary Godfrey within the records of the St. Benedict's Church were her 1921 marriage certificate and the record of the baptism 2 years later of her daughter, my mother. What of the first 6 years of her life? Nothing more of those years is recorded. Her birth with the name Mary Godfrey, her father's identity, the existence of any brothers or sisters, the circumstances of her baptism into the Catholic Church, if in fact she was Catholic, and any other events of her young life are not recorded. From this privation, an imperative emerged in me with each frustrated attempt to see a life from records that instead occluded it. If she was six at the time of her admission to St. Benedict, she would have been born in 1898. There's no Mary Godfrey in the records of colored births in Charleston in those years, nor is there a baptism noted in Catholic Church's records. Father Hopkins' life, replete with intriguing gaps and inconsistencies, might provide some clue to my grandmother's early life. What did Father Hopkins have to do with Mary, and why did he bring her to New York in 1904? The only documentary evidence I have been able to find connecting Father Hopkins to anyone named Washington was found in documents submitted to the court during the proceedings to probate his will in 1905. A single entry in the statement of disbursements refers to a disbursement made to Phoebe Washington, the caretaker of the Hopkins Villa. Could Phoebe be the grandmother of Mary Godfrey, mother of Mary Washington? The 1880 federal census records Phoebe as a resident of Somerville, 27 years old, Black, and as the head of a household which consisted of her three children, a brother and a sister. One of those children is Mary Washington, age 6. Mary, according to the record, was born in 1874, which would have made her 24 in 1898, the year of Mary Godfrey's birth. The next record of Phoebe was in 1900, where she's listed with 6 children, 2 of whom were deceased. Mary Washington is not among the living children. Mary could have died and could be the deceased mother of Mary Godfrey listed on the orphanage record. From these sparse facts from the case, it is at least plausible. Whatever motivated Father Hopkins, Christian love, guilt, money, a parental duty, a deathbed act of kindness, hedging a life of luxury, he brought her north to an orphanage in which she would be educated, a rite by no means certain in late 19th century South Carolina. She came north, barely aware of the South from which she came, taught the value of an education and tempted by the luxury of self-determination. What she learned or felt or reached for or struggled for is unknown to me, except in the imprint she made on her daughter, who was also unaware of or undaunted by limitation and audacious enough to walk out of her fate. Ultimately, it is my mother that I'm searching. I could hear her silences. I believe Mary Godfrey taught her that what is inconvenient and no longer relevant is expendable, and there's nothing sacred or even very genuine about the truth. If anyone passed with any consciousness, it was my mother. If anyone chose to walk out of her history to embrace a life of creative insecurity, it was my mother. I can never return to the place of my origin, nor answer all of the questions, but ultimately, like my grandmother and my mother, my history is necessarily an act of creativity and imagination, an indulgence in not belonging, a migration. Thank you.
Thank you, Ellen. It's always good to hear the work that you're doing in progress on this memoir. And this is probably the third or fourth iteration that I've heard. And it keeps taking a different shape. Mm-hmm. And I'm excited and proud of the research that you continue to do and the beautiful writing. I'd now like to have us turn to Tiffany Gill, who will share her work with us. And this is also one of my favorite projects that's ongoing now. Tiffany Gill, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you to Cheryl and to Ellen and to Deb and for the entire Women and Migrations working group for helping me to expand how I see my own scholarship and for the model of intellectual sisterhood that it has provided. So as a historian of Black leisure, my research archive is saturated with glamour, with international intrigue and expressions of joy. And in this historic moment, pregnant with pain, but also possibility, attending to my work has seemed frivolous, at best counterproductive to the Black freedom struggle at worst. However, as I immerse myself in the memoirs of Black women international travelers, who not only had the desire to embrace mobility as a liberatory practice in the tradition of the enslaved women Jennifer Morgan centered in her remarks last week, but the audacity to chronicle their observations, I have come to realize that their work, rather than being counter to the aims of our current or past Black freedom struggles, instead helped to elucidate the promise and pleasures of freedom in important ways. So in the brief time I have with you this afternoon, I would like to examine Black women's international travel memoirs in the 1930s. The women, one a member of the working class, one an ambitious school teacher, and the other a daughter of the Black elite, made a claim to the world and to their place in it. And I invite you to join me in thinking about how these travel memoirs of Black women can be instructive in our contemporary moment of crisis and revolutionary possibility. So born in Columbus, Mississippi during the 1887 yellow fever outbreak, Juanita Harrison dreamed of a world beyond her small cotton town. Her schooling ended before she hit puberty and she joined the only consistent workforce available to Black women in the Jim Crow South. She scrubbed white people's floors, cooked their meals, and ironed their clothes. In the few moments she could spare away from their watchful eyes, Juanita admits she would peruse their magazines and get lost in the images of what she later called, quote, templed cities in foreign lands. Harrison gained a reputation as a good worker and recognized that her profession as a domestic, a hindrance to mobility in the Jim Crow South, could actually be her ticket to the world. And so from 1927 to 1935, Harrison traveled to 22 countries in Asia and Europe, a remarkable feat. While her people in her native Mississippi suffered mercilessly through the Great Depression, Harrison was making her way across two continents with very few financial concerns. She knew her skills as a domestic were always in demand and explained, "I don't know how much, but I'll always know how to get a job. I don't care what country I'm in." Ironically, her precarious place within the US economy is what gave her mobility abroad. Not only did she travel, but she kept a diary of her experiences abroad, never expecting that her musings would be published. The entries are raw and written in a way that reflected her substandard Jim Crow education and truncated schooling. However, the misspellings and creative grammar could not obscure Harrison's great intellect and insight. She was masterful at reading a room and reading people to get what she needed and often what she wanted. Through the encouragement of her former employer, her journal entries were first serialized in Atlantic Monthly and eventually published as a book, as a memoir, with a very audacious title, My Great, Wide, Beautiful World. The audaciousness in language is in many ways ahead of its time and reminds me of the 21st century Black millennials who lay claim to the world for themselves in blogs and other areas. The book sold well and was reviewed widely in places like the New York Times. According to one reviewer, its power came from the fact that, quote, "It is the story of a servant girl who was born in Mississippi, but demonstrated the fact that she didn't have to stay there. In fact," the reviewer continued, "the main significance of Miss Harrison's book is that a first-class colored servant can make her living anywhere in the world." However, Harrison's memoir reveals a much more compelling and complicated story. Harrison not only understood how to capitalize on a global political economy that rendered domestic service a reliable way to make money, but exploited the arbitrariness of racial designation. Described as having slight form, fresh olive complexion, and a long hair braided around her head. This is a later picture of Harrison. There are actually very few pictures of Harrison that remain. Harrison used confusion about her identity to access work, but more importantly, to access the joys of travel that were often relegated to the elite. For example, during her time in the Middle East, Harrison's journal entry for October 7th simply reads, quote, "At Aleppo, they thought I was Chinese. Here they think I'm Arabian." In another entry, Harrison reveals, quote, "I am willing to be whatever I can to get the best treatment." And while she worked to support herself while abroad, she did not live the life of a working class domestic. Harrison's memoir is full of her pursuit of pleasure, sexual or otherwise. In other words, she lived a life of freedom unimaginable for a domestic worker from the Jim Crow South. Harrison's travel memoir was part of a growing genre of Black women's travel writings in the 1930s. In 1939, Zaytella Turner, a professor and scholar of English, spent 1 year at the University of London studying Shakespeare, and she published a memoir about her time titled My Wonderful Year. Turner was clear about the purpose of her book. Quote, "It was intended to be entertaining for the person who has no intention of ever going abroad, but who is interested in the people and customs of other countries." In just about every way, Turner could not be more different than Harrison, and it was reflected in her memoir. Born in Kansas City, she attended the University of Kansas and worked as a college professor. In 1935, she was awarded Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority's Foreign Fellowship. So she left Kansas and headed to Europe aboard the SS Normandy. The Normandy, the largest passenger ship of its time, was a marvel, and Turner was determined to describe every detail of the ship for her readers. She noted that, quote, "One can find as many pleasures as they are in a big city, concerts, the Grand Salon, bridge tournaments, cinemas, chapels," and she goes on and on and on in rich detail. And the book continues with this level of detail. She tells us about her cabin, number 828. She describes the four-poster bed, the three wardrobes, a luxurious rug. Her excitement and vivid descriptions only underscored the stated mission of her memoir, which is to bring this journey to life for those who may never get to go. And I think this is important to keep in mind when reading Turner's descriptions of her encounters once she arrives in Europe. For example, of her time in London, Turner explained that, quote, "writing alone at night without any fear for the first time in the world's largest city made me feel grateful for the circumstances that has sent me adventuring." Even more striking, she describes her encounter with law enforcement in London. She explains, quote, "I looked upon the London policeman as a friend who could offer regular help with maps and streets." She continues, "for the first time in my life, I learned to welcome the sight of a policeman." For a Black audience, then and perhaps even now, still raw from the devastation of the Harlem riot in 1935 and everyday encounters with police violence, Turner's depiction of an alternative racial and gendered hierarchy where Black women could feel safe on city streets after dark and where police were welcome and helpful sounded like science fiction. Since Turner is quite aware that most of her audience will never make it to London, I contend that these depictions are included to provide a tangible vision for Black Americans of what Black freedom could look and feel like, and perhaps even a subtle admonition to work to bring such a vision to pass. Finally, I am currently working through the travel memoirs of a woman named Faye McKean Hershaw, who authored or co-authored three travel memoirs from 1938 to 1950. Hershaw and her travel companion and co-author, Florenstein Sendstack Collins, were daughters of the Black elite. Hershaw's father, Lafayette McKean Hershaw, was once the highest civil servant in the US and an activist who was one of the founders, along with W.B. Du Bois, of the Niagara Movement. Collins, her travel companion, was a favored niece of Robert Abbott, the wealthy and powerful founder of the Chicago Defender. Their joint memoir, Around the World with Hershaw and Collins, published in 1938, is rich in so many ways. But in my remaining few minutes or seconds, I would just like to highlight the visual archive these women produced. Indeed, photographs are the dominant language they use to invite their readers into their world and to see the world through a Black woman's eyes. In the foreword, after explaining that they had, quote, "had a longing to visit dark people's countries," and a footnote explains that the photographs were taken by Faye Hershaw herself, with the exception of just four, they simultaneously, through their photographs, show solidarity with, quote, "the darker peoples of the world," but also that very uncomfortable othering Western gaze that often is too common in travel photographs. For example, of the people of Penang, Malaysia, she says that people go barefooted, although the man in the photograph here is wearing sandals and wore little clothes, she says, but that they were friendly to tourists, especially the dark ones. So here, Blackness was actually favored. Comments on people in India include words like, "the people are very dark, some are Black." And finally, here's the only image, there are tons of images in her work, but just for the sake of time, this is the only image in which the women appear themselves in rickshaws in Colombo, Sri Lanka. So as you can see from this glimpse into these photos, this is a rich archive to think through the ways that Black women navigate the complexities of being a part of an oppressed group in their home country, but also the embodiment of the privileges of the American imperial project when traveling abroad. So those of us who have committed our personal and professional lives to collecting and chronicling Black women's stories must never forget to acknowledge not only their pain, but the ways they not only dreamed of freedom, to loosely paraphrase Robin Kelly, but expanded its contours and laid claim to it in unconventional ways. Sometimes that meant racially passing to travel to 22 countries. Other times it meant reminding others of a different model of policing. At other times it was allowing us to see the world through the lens of their cameras. In each case, no matter how messy or complicated their narratives and memoirs may be, these women remind us that not only do Black lives matter, but so too does Black living. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Tiffany. And again, it's great to hear that chapter and to see where you are with this really, really important work about how Black women, travelers especially, are writing themselves into history, how they're visualizing themselves as well as they travel, and some of the devices that they use for survival during these travels abroad. I'd now like to welcome Gayatri Gopinath, who's going to be joining us next. Gayatri.
Hi, can everyone see my screen? Okay, hi everyone, I'm Gayatri Gopinath. I teach in the Department of Social and Cultural Analysis at NYU. I'm also the director of the Center for the Study of Gender and Sexuality there. And I want to also begin by thanking Deb, Cheryl, Ellen for bringing us together. It's been a real source of joy and sustenance to be a part of this conversation with this incredible group of scholars and activists and artists over the past 3 years. So thank you so much for convening us. So I want to begin by saying that I really appreciated Tanya Selvaratnam's remarks last week in our session, where she was asking us to think about what brown allyship with Black lives means at this moment. I've been very heartened during this current uprising against police violence by how progressive South Asians are speaking up and making deep connections between anti-Black racism in the US and Hindu nationalism in South Asia, specifically between anti-Blackness and the fascist platform of the Modi government in India. What these voices make clear is that true South Asian allyship means that combating anti-Black racism in the US must also mean combating Hindu nationalism and its anti-Dalit, anti-Muslim platform, both in India and in the diaspora. As a South Asian ally, you cannot do one without the other. You need that transnational frame that links these connected forms of brutality and oppression. So it's in that context that I want to bring into our collective conversation the work of the Pakistani-American artist Shazia Sikandar. For those of you who may not be familiar with her work, Sikandar is one of the most prominent contemporary artists in the South Asian diaspora. She's originally from Lahore, Pakistan, where she was trained in the tremendously labor-intensive tradition of Indo-Persian miniature painting. She came to the US as a young adult and has been living and working in the US, mostly New York, since the early 1990s. Over the course of 3 decades, her work has stood, I would say, as the very antithesis of the fictions of purity and authentic national culture subscribed to by the authoritarian regimes we see both in India and in the US. And her work has always enacted the kind of transnational connections that I'm calling for. Instead, Sikandar demands that we understand tradition, culture, identity as impure, heterogeneous, always in process, as Stuart Hall says. As such, Sikandar offers us a different mapping of South Asia as well as the US, one that lays bare the arbitrariness of geopolitical lines of control and that radically disrupts taken for granted national, temporal, and art historical boundaries. Sikandar's work traffics in what I call promiscuous intimacies. The word promiscuous is derived from the Latin miscere, meaning to mix. We can understand Sikandar's work as promiscuous in the sense that it exposes the intimacies, the deeply imbricated nature of apparently discrete cultural traditions, histories, and geographies. So the category of memoir, which is of course our theme for today, is a tricky one to use in relation to Sikandar, precisely because the reception of her, to her work has invariably been through the lens of her biography as Muslim, Pakistani, female, often in reductive and essentializing terms. This was particularly true early on in her career in the mid-90s, when she was the first woman of South Asian origin to really gain any visibility in the contemporary art scene in the US. And, you know, I think this is a dilemma that many artists of color, particularly women artists from the Global South, face, that sort of reductive quality to thinking about biography in relation to their work. So Sikandar has consistently pushed against being read solely through her biography. She does so by destabilizing the very categories through which the autobiographical I appears. Gender itself, what it means to be woman, the boundaries of human and inhuman and non-human are all rendered unstable in her work. But at the same time, she is crafting a genealogy for herself that is indeed autobiographical, but always on her own terms. For instance, a recurring image in her paintings is that of a floating headless feminine figure with roots for feet. And you see this, I hope this shows up, but this is the image that I'm talking about, this obscured image of a female torso with roots for feet. And that is actually headless. So the head here is not connected to the torso. So this is a painting from 1997. And I would say this is an apt image for her own positionality as an artist, where home and roots are not tied to a particular place, but rather are mobile and contingent. Secunda's insistence in her visual vocabulary on mobility over fixity is exemplified by this image of, in her own words, quote, a self-nourishing, uprooted female figure that refuses to belong, to be fixed, to be grounded, or to be stereotyped, end quote. This figure de-essentializes the female body by blurring the boundary between the human and non-human, plant and animal. But the image is also inherently a violent one, where the fragmented female body belies any easy recuperation of diasporic mobility as necessarily celebratory or emancipatory. Thus, the headless figure with roots for feet is a deeply ambivalent image. It connotes the sense of both potentiality and peril that emerges from the contradictory space of diasporic rootedness. Secunda's turn to tradition is radically anti-nostalgic in that she both utilizes and dismantles the idiom of Indo-Persian miniature painting in order to imagine a different present and future. This is particularly apparent in her 1995 work, Venus's Wonderland, which indeed envisions a wonderland of queer utopian possibility. The viewer is immediately confronted by a riotous assemblage of figures, human and non-human, that quite literally spill out of the frame. We see here a disorienting collision of multiple art historical traditions and cultural vocabularies, images of archetypal femininity from Islamic, Hindu, Christian, and pre-Christian mythologies are quite literally fragmented, layered, submerged, obscured, and entangled with each other, and with earth, sky, water, and non-human entities. Gender as a stable category of identity is exploded. The work instead evinces a radical interspecies relationality and interdependence of human and non-human, animate and inanimate worlds. The veil, that overdetermined and fetishized marker of Muslim femininity, is here shredded into tendrils and rendered in white and red paint so that it both obscures and reveals simultaneously. Veils cover both human and non-human figures so as to render their meaning as gendered signifiers absurd and nonsensical. In Secunda's 2001 painting, Pleasure Pillars, we see Secunda's signature juxtaposition of archetypal feminine forms from different art historical traditions. Sensuous dancing women straight out of Mughal and Rajput miniatures flank a pair of headless torsos of Venus and a Hindu goddess. A self-portrait of the artist's own face, crowned with enormous spiraling horns, floats above the torsos, in a sense serving as one head that connects the two torsos. Secunda here suggests that her own aesthetic genealogy draws from multiple religious, cultural, and geographic traditions of female pleasure, potency, and eroticism. But these figures of an exuberant and unbridled sensuality are shadowed by the chilling insertion of two winged entities, and that's at the top of the image, instruments of destruction from different temporal planes, a streamlined fighter jet that hovers like a baleful bird above the entire vista of the painting, and a dragon-like creature, perhaps out of Persian mythology, emitting fire from its limbs. Secunda added the fighter jet to an earlier version of the painting in the direct aftermath of 9/11. Indeed, the painting's representation of gendered bodies takes on a particular valence in the context of imperial war and carnage at the start of Bush's war on terror. It's worth recalling that the initial human rights justification for the invasion of Afghanistan in 2001 was to, quote, save Muslim women from Islamic extremism. Pleasure Pillars speaks back to such paternalistic discourses and insists on revivifying submerged genealogies of pleasurable, sensuous, and joyous gendered embodiments. But as with Venus's Wonderland, the painting cannot be entirely contained by reading that sees it as simply celebrating a cross-cultural feminist genealogy. The spiraling horns in the artist's self-portrait disrupt any such attempt. Secunda's so-called women are fragmented, opaque, hybrid entities that refuse wholeness or bodily integrity. Pleasure pillars, and indeed all of Sikandar's paintings, suggest an alternative architecture of gender. They resist the grids and straight lines of gender and sexual normativity, and instead spiral, loop, and scatter across multiple temporal and geographic terrains. As such, Sikandar's backward glance offers us a vision of a more livable future that embraces the promiscuous intimacies of our shared past and presents. Now, more than ever, do we need this radical, expansive vision. Thank you.
Thank you, Gayatri, for sharing the work that you've done on Sikandar's really important oeuvre, especially thinking about the instability, as you put it, of gender identity and how in the many layers of her work, she's showing us a cross-cultural feminist genealogy. That's something that's coming through over the decades of the work that she's produced. And I'm sorry, I'm almost in my wrap-up mode, so let me stop the wrap-up mode and pass the baton on to Elaine, who's our next speaker.
Welcome, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today. And I want to start by thanking Deborah Willis and the organizer for inviting me to be part of this amazing discussion. I've been following all of the other talks, and it's been really wonderful to learn from everyone's practices in documenting these stories. My name is Yelene Rodriguez, and I'm a visual artist and an independent curator. I received my BFA in fashion design from the New School in 2013, and I'm currently pursuing my master's at NYU in Latin America and Caribbean Studies with a concentration in museum studies as well. My focus is mostly in the Afro-Caribbean diaspora. I am a child of Dominican immigrants, and I was born and raised in New York. And that kind of like influenced my upbringing and allowed me to see the island from a different point of view, right, instead of if I was born in the island. So my work is heavily influenced by the social and political issues embedded in the Dominican Republic and Haiti. And I wanted to use my resources and my knowledge in sewing and creating sculptures to create images that tell the different narratives from the Dominican Republic and Haiti that is not one of that is common in the mainstream media of hatred and separation and racism. I wanted to show the different contributions that have come from the island of Hispaniola and how one specific event has created a ripple effect throughout the rest of the world and how this island has participated a lot in the makeup of not only the Caribbean, but Latin America and even the States. So I started this series called We Are Here Because You Were There, inspired by Stuart Hall. And I looked at different orishas and deities found specifically in the Afrosyncretic religion in the Dominican Republic and Haiti, so voodoo and santeria, to show the similarities and put them into conversations with each other. Today, I'm only showing you one specific project and its different forms. I wanted to show you guys this piece inspired by the Haitian Revolution and the ceremony of 1791. When I was in the fashion industry, I realized I didn't want to participate anymore in creating images that erased or misrepresented the Dominican Republic and Haiti. And I wanted to shift that conversation from us being a vacation island and showing like these different stories. So here I selected a friend of mine that is and her child to sit as Azili Dantor, who is considered the mother of Haiti and who was called upon during the ceremony to guide them in the revolution. And what I found intriguing about this piece, about that story, is that her image is adopted by the Black Madonna, that was brought to the island by the Polish soldiers sent by the Napoleon army to control the revolution. What happened was that most of the soldiers eventually joined the Haitian army. And this image of the Black Madonna was adapted as a Zile Dantor. What I find really amazing about this religion is how it has been adapted by all throughout the Caribbean, Cuba, Puerto Rico, and even in New Orleans. And it shows me that this is kind of like a form of resistance from the African diaspora to try to keep these narratives and these stories alive. And I wanted to continue to do that in my practice. So as a visual artist, I create the garments, I hand weave them, and I also try to implement my upbringing in the States with the abolitionist movement, thinking about those stories that I was able to connect with when I was a child in New York, and I was learning about the enslaved African in the States and that narrative, connecting to that story. So I want to bring those narratives together with my work. This is the installation view of it during my residency at Wave Hill. And here, I want to show you guys the performance video of it. This is a 2-minute video, pretty short, but it incorporates all of these influences from the Dominican Republic, from Haiti, and in the States, and try to bring all of these narratives together and bring it into into the digital world. So here the video is basically just showing the garment in itself, and it goes further into it's like a four-stepped video in scenes. So here she's just static, and then you see the dancers calling upon her to bring her into the space. And then it ends with her joining the dancers. And my goal with this piece is to bring people in my circle, women in my circle, to have them see themselves as these goddesses and to learn about the culture and the history that was pretty much taken away from us, so they can feel inspired and the conversation continues to pass on. And for them to feel that they're being represented, even if in the mainstream media, there's a lack of that, I want to use my time here as an artist to bring them into this performance and into my practice, so they can teach it and pass it forward. All right, thank you.
Thank you so much, Elaine. It's my first time seeing that work, and I'm just so excited to continue the conversation with you when we finish. And just the way in which you talked about, you know, the layering of memoir and history, and through your practice, especially as an artist, but also someone who has such a deep connection to the fashion industry, and how the work that you're doing is work that we can use to confront the mainstream narrative. It's really important to reinforce that. I also just want to remind everyone who's joining us today to please use the question function. The question function will enable you to ask questions of our panelists when we wrap up. And so we look forward to receiving your questions when you put them there, and we'll be addressing those as we finish. Our next speaker is Bryn Evans. Bryn, are you ready? Of Columbia University.
Yes, I am. Thank you so much, Cheryl.
You're welcome. And formerly of Spelman College, a domestic scholar last semester. Thank you.
Hi. Yes, my name is Bryn Evans. I study Africana Studies and Art History at Columbia University, where I'm a rising senior. And I want to extend my deepest gratitude to the organizers for an opportunity to present on two topics that have been giving me a bit of heartache recently, migration and memory. Both take their former and potential manifestations as their primary sites of inquiry. They are haunted, almost selfish words in that way. And considerations of women and our movement, which, let it be known, should not exist merely as a consideration, but as a central understanding of every one of our unique and multiplicitous realities, we often and very necessarily discuss our displacement, our deportation, our incarceration, our trafficking, our disappearing, our experiencing the spatial and temporal violence, how we are removed across geography and existence. To the point where, if someone asked me what moving throughout time space on my own terms would look like, no gaze to oversee me, no border to confine me, no skin to define me, I don't quite know where my response would begin. Today, I'm more certain that it should begin in the self. Memoir, to me, is driven by that self-response, the recollection of myself for myself, the holding of myself for myself. That's what makes it so simple and so hard. I began this meditation surrounding Solange Knowles when I get home. For the purpose of our conversation today, though, I have to rewind back to what I've deemed the album's gospel prelude. Discography, like all bodies, bears the gift and the burden of collective memory. Weary is my favorite track and A Seat at the Table because it doesn't leave us in mourning. It situates grief in a call and response with relief. I'm haunted by this notion of looking for one's body. And right here you can see a couple stanzas of lyrics. Looking for one's glory. I do think of the song as a prayer, but it is also a lament. The suggestion of the disembodied, the repossession of something that is a part of you, though you've been told it is not yours to be had. The weariness moves you to look for it anyway. That's the prayer. Sister tells us that you're leaving not a trace in the world, but you're facing the world. She shifts effortlessly through the first and second person address, this call and response, this gospel, allows for a movement across time space. It's not only her speaking to us, but also her calling out to the future body, that future glory that she's looking for. The refrain, "I'll be back real soon," is a conflation of time and space too. She speaks to distance in duration. So I want us to hear it and see it, whatever that means to you and your body right now. And I'll be playing at the end of my presentation. But sometimes to really see something, I have to look down or close my eyes. At times I hear something best when it's muted. But first, I feel that it would be irresponsible if I did not emphasize the very real implications of the webinar's theme in my own presentation. Remy Fells, Nakia Crawford, Ryan Milton, Nina Pop, Monica Diamond, Breonna Taylor, Toyin Salau. I'm not naming all of the names because I do not know all of their names, and that is precisely the issue. Perhaps it's the fact that my older sister is also named Breonna, that she is also a 20-something-year-old essential worker, whatever that means, whose life's passion is to make a difference in the medical field during a pandemic, no less. Perhaps it's because she's moved out now and I don't always know what time she gets home or goes to sleep or wakes up for the day. Perhaps I, like migration and memory, am a selfish word too. It cannot be overstated that any death at the hands of the police is deserving of mourning, and that some folks are mourned more than others. I intend to be gentle yet deliberate when I criticize our selective amnesia regarding Black death. Here I am speaking directly to the organizing efforts which have reached an international scale beautifully, but have surrounded Black cisgendered men and relegated our sisters to the margins. I speak to half-hearted expressions of grief that position Black femmes, non-binary, and trans women at the end of the list, if at all. Here I amplify Dr. Brittany Cooper, who asks, why are Black women and girls still an afterthought? We bear the weight of our fathers, of our sons, of our partners, of our brothers, of each other, of ourselves. We suffer the brunt of all of the systems, all of them. We do it with love and pride. All that love is not reciprocated. We are forced to rely on ourselves for relief. I cannot articulate how much pain I feel that my sister's names have turned into headlines, into battle cries, into mourning. My discussion of women and migration brings me heartache because my sisters and I are dying, but perhaps more tragically, because we are the ones mobilizing and no one will mobilize for us. We are dying and the outrage just isn't there. We are dying and the incident reports are all but blank. We are dying and no one is willing to move. Yet we are the ones who migrate and who march and who mother movements again and again and again. What does that mean for our memory, our memoir? As I open this dialogue, I urge you to engage a clip of Solange performing Weary, a song that I am dedicating today and mourning of Toy and Salau, who you now see on your screen. And as you're watching, return to this question, who moves you? Thank you. And Tom, I'm ready.
Not a trace in the world. Or your face in the world.
Thank you so much, Bryn, for that really thoughtful meditation, dedication, and question for us, you know, who moves you, especially in this moment of pain and grief. Thank you for that. I'd like to now introduce and welcome our last speaker, Destiny Fillmore, a rising senior at Spelman College. And again, I also want to ask you all to please send us your questions. Destiny.
Hello, everyone. Thank you all for having me. For various reasons, Mildred Thompson's biography is becoming increasingly more known. Her inclusion in several major museum exhibitions, especially Magnetic Fields, which take its name from her work, a more recent solo exhibition at the Spelman College Museum of Fine Art, representation by Gallery Le Long, and the dedicated work of Melissa Messina have moved her from art history's periphery towards its center. Other scholars have explored and shared Mildred Thompson's biography and artwork in a way that is normative and linear. But my interest in place and memory encouraged me to contextualize her biography in those terms. I want to tell Mildred's story from the perspective of place, not simply by what, but where and when. Before I begin focusing on her time in Tampa, Florida, I want to give a general outline of Mildred Thompson's biography and her migrations around the country and world. She was someone who, even by today's standards, as you can see, was exceptionally well-traveled. When I mapped her movements, the shape instantly reminded me of the power lines that I had photographed in a series titled The Lines That Connect Us. That series contemplates home, memories, and the archive. In this way, and many more, Mildred Thompson's memoir is connected with my own, and as I've conducted this research, they become increasingly entangled. To guide my search, I have asked three questions. What changed about Mildred Thompson in Tampa? How did place and space influence her work? And what impact did Mildred have on these places while she was there and here? And also, what remains? I find that this quote, sourced from a letter she wrote while living there, is a wonderful answer to this first question. It reads, "The days are light and hot and wonderful. I love the weather, my home, my work and studio. I think I finally found myself." Her work, which was experimental at this time, mainly done in wood, lithographic prints, and a late foray back into oil painting, was very well received by the city's art community. Several collectors visited her studio, they threw cocktail parties in her honor. Her exhibition openings were always well attended and reported, and she sold a good amount of work. Her teaching philosophy and abilities, which were developed during her time in Germany, strengthened and evolved. She taught at a local community center called The New Place and also at Hillsborough Community College. At The New Place, classes advertised for a very specific demographic often morphed into beautiful melting pots where adults and children created alongside one another. Parents marveled at the works that their children created, but also at how well-managed Mildred's classroom was. Place and space influenced her work quite profoundly. Mildred was incredibly productive in her studio, and this is because it was so spacious, foreshadowing the importance of space for the scale of her work that she did later in Atlanta. Her studio was also bright, and it allowed her to engage with others throughout her entire creative process. Local cigar rollers, tourists, and various other passerby would stop and watch her work with the large power tools needed to properly sculpt wood. They offered advice, affirmations, and encouraged her to continue on with the sculptures and also to challenge herself. The wood used within the Allegro series that she created while in Tampa actually came from local spruce trees and exemplifies a very direct impact of Tampa on her creative process. Her use of this particular lumber with their thick trunks and prickly needles also ties her to Florida's Black history. Many Floridians worked at lumber mills throughout the peninsula and built towns, businesses, and lives around them. These mills could be identified as the reason, or one of the reasons, for Florida's economic success in the early years of its statehood. Spruce Street, aptly named for the tree, cuts through one of Tampa's oldest historically Black neighborhoods that also happens to be a very short drive away from her studio, which is located in the historic Ybor City District. Upon arriving to Tampa, Mildred discovered that she was meant to act as a bridge between Tampa's Black community and the Tampa Bay Arts Center. I find that she was quite successful in this endeavor and want to share a quote from an autobiographical essay that she penned in 1987. It reads, "One fine October morning, I drove up to the new place and began unloading the gallon cans of paint. Children began to gather to watch me. When I began opening the cans and placing brushes in all of those pretty colors, the children became excited and wanted to know what I was going to do. 'This is going to be the flower wall,' I told them, and began to paint the outlines of big, floppy flowers. Soon we were about 15 painting flowers on the wall. By late afternoon, we were about 50. There were also many adults who stopped to watch and would fill in just a dash of red or touch of a bit of yellow after being urged on by the children. When I arrived at the new place the next morning, the children were there waiting. They had brought friends with them, and during the day, the crowds grew, as did the flowers. By the third day, the whole wall sparkled with big, bright floral colors. After a week, the flower wall was finished, and it became the talk of Ybor City." Unfortunately, this mural and the place where it was created no longer exist. Where her studio once stood is now a lively bar attached to a taqueria in the home of Cephas's small juice bar. Her apartment is nothing but air now. I thought that perhaps by speculating and wondering, I could connect with what was. Perhaps by looking and listening, I could measure the changes and continuities in this place where we both made homes. So I went to Ybor and I brought a camera along with me. I kept Jordan Castile's words in mind as I began to capture what I saw. The photograph becomes a model of detachment from the real. It becomes a memory space as opposed to a physical representation of a time spent together. I created this work to engage with this memory space and to build a time machine of sorts. By overlaying archival images with my own, I allow the past and present to have a conversation with one another and can imagine the world through Mildred's eyes. Confined to the block where her studio space was, I wondered what had changed since 1974 and what hadn't. I know the sounds of cars passing by had not changed. The streets there are cobblestone, so you can hear their tires rattle and bounce against the ground, whether they zoom past in a hurry or cruise by casually. I know the famous chickens who announce their presence nearly every 15 minutes like clockwork were here. The train, which still runs behind her building, surely clunked noisily on its way then as it does now. I found that much has remained and even more has changed, but I also found new understanding of a place that I had visited countless times before. For me, and hopefully in the future for others, this place will never be the same. It is forever marked by my knowing what once stood on those grounds. Simply knowing and searching for Mildred Thompson's presence here, I have altered the history of the place. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Destiny, and thank you all for your presentations. And Destiny, I think I'm going to begin, and I'll move very quickly because I see what time it is, and I'm also aware that we have 7 questions waiting in the queue. I want to remind everyone, if you have questions, to please present those to us through the Q&A function. Now we have 8. But I just wanted to say a few words about all of your presentations and thinking about memoir in the areas in which you all study and work as scholar, artists, writers, activists, women. And also, I'd like to just maybe say a few words from Toni Morrison as well. So Destiny, for your presentation, one of the things that I think I'm gonna go backwards just because that's the way I've been writing. One of the things I really wanted to point out is the way in which, with the work that you've done on Mildred Thompson, you are not just writing about Thompson as an art historian, you're an art history major, but you're also thinking about her work as a writer, scholar, memoirist, and a photographer yourself, that the way that you're presenting her work to us today is through, you know, through the history of documents that you've collected about her, especially as it relates to your hometown, Tampa. But I want to point out around thinking about creatively working in memoir and how we can really change what the work of a memoirist might do, the work of a writer might do, the work of an art historian might do, is that you've very strongly taken hold of your own voice and inserted it and sort of paired it with hers. And we see that with the photographs that you've made, but we also hear that in your writing. And I think that's a really powerful tool and a really important way to think about a different way that Black women can write themselves into history and also change the way that we think about art history as a discipline. And then Bryn, I wanted to say something more about your work and especially to note that you're, Bryn, you're a scholar of Africana studies, but you're also a poet. And I think that if anyone was listening closely to your prayer and your lament, that they'll see that you have great talent in thinking through memory and migration. You said those are these two sort of pieces that have really been begging at you in your work as a poet, and to also encourage us to, you know, to begin with the self in the work that you're doing. And I think you gave us all something that we're most of us familiar with, that is the work of Solange Knowles, to really think through these issues and this question about who moves you, a meditation that is really important for, as I said before, the moment in which we find ourselves today. And I want to thank you again for sharing with us Toyin Salau, and also sharing that moment of dedication to her life and what she has come to stand for. Elaine, there are quite a few questions for you in the queue, so I'm gonna be brief, but I just again want to emphasize the way in which you have done, you know, not just work in the fashion industry, that you have this, you know, the skill and this talent with fabric, but it's something that, at least to my mind, when I see the project that you shared with us, that the layering and the draping and the construction and the weaving and the weave and the wove and the pattern of fabric is something that really, in a visual way, but also in a sort of a 3D physical way, influences how you present the narratives that you're sharing with us, how you think about memoir, not only based on cultural heritage and thinking about, you know, this island of Hispaniola, right? And thinking about, you know, Haiti and the Dominican Republic and these two different histories, but also the ways in which religion especially is shaped in these spaces through the image of the Black Madonna, but also through really curiously in your presentation of the installation through some of these very iconic images from the abolitionist movement. So we look forward to hearing from you more about that work as well. And Gayatri, I'm actually going to kind of go back to this to this sort of device, I think, of thinking about you know, layering, especially in the work of Sikander, as you share with us, but also thinking about how I think in much of the artists and works that you all have shared today, that we really have to think about, as you put it, you know, this instability of assumption with regards to gender identity, and how that is presented not only in the work of a contemporary artist, but how, as a Muslim Pakistani female, she's really pushing back against the kind of mainline biographies that that the contemporary art world has put out there for her. And she does this in her work, that she really calls this out in her work. And I think that through the multiple images that she presents in her work and some of the examples that you showed to us, she's calling this out in a way that it almost becomes indiscernible for many of these mainline voices to understand, that they don't have the language or the ability or the bandwidth to really quite understand in the kinds of reductive terms in which they typically place her. And Tiffany, in your work on Black women's international travel narratives, it was just a delight to see this work coming together, especially from the 1930s, and also hearing about women that I know, some of them I was not aware of. I cannot wait to find my own copy of each of these narratives that you shared. And I started to think, when you were presenting, especially the work of photography and text by Faye Hershaw and I can't remember the name of the other woman right now, but you know, it just made me think about, you know, where I began, which are, you know, the words that in the last two iterations of our conversations, Ellen has shared that, you know, well, we began in Florence, we have met in Abu Dhabi, we were meant to be meeting in Athens, and here we are meeting around the world through this webinar series. And, you know, just the way in which we all have this great urge to keep moving, and what it means, it kind of makes us, I think, stop and contemplate and meditate, you know, where we are, and that we are in this space and not able to have, you know, the kind of chutzpah, if you will, that these Black women travelers of the 1930s did to be able to keep on moving, if you will. And then finally, Ellen, I'd like to just, you know, begin or end rather with you and thinking about how you presented so many really important documents that have led you to understand more about who you are, more about who your mother and your grandmother were. But you still have questions, and you still have questions for us. And I think one of the things that stood out for me was the way in which you talked about hearing silences, you know, and that's kind of like when I pun intended, hear that phrase, it really takes me a moment to really understand, you know, what that means, to really to listen hard, but also to hear the silence, to see the invisible in the kinds of documents that you share with us. And these are legal documents, photographs, that beautiful, stylish photograph Margaret Leader Toscano from 1945 that you shared with us, that these are the kinds of things that we as artists, scholars, writers, memoirists use in order to construct the stories that we want to shape and tell for ourselves. So I think I've talked way too long. I'm sorry about that, but you've been so inspiring. And I'm going to go to the questions, which we have 12 now. I'll probably give a link in the chat to everyone related to the piece by Toni Morrison that I wanted to share with you. So I'm going to begin with a question by Cheryl Antonio. And this is a question for anyone and everyone on the panel. The idea of memoir, she says, and this is in, you know, quotations, the idea of memoir, to me anyway, suggests the tension between public and private. Has that been a consideration in your work?
So, I can thank you, Cheryl, for the question and for joining us, our colleague at Tisch. My story is a story I've been asked before whether I have hesitation about sharing a story that maybe doesn't belong to me, that it's a very private story of people who self-fashioned, who decided who they wanted to be, and did I have a right, or did I have feelings about the fact that I was revealing that secret? And my answer to that generally is, though it's very personal, it is my story. You know, it is at least as much story of mine as it is of theirs. And it's about a deprivation. It's about something that was lost to me, the right to know something about them and about all of the people that came before them. I know so much about my father's family, about the Italian side of my family. I can and have gone to Italy and met relatives and understand a lot about their life by visiting them. But that has been lost to me and my mother's family. So I think it's a kind of recovery of self.
Thank you, Ellen. Is there anyone else that'd like to respond to that question? Because I do have other questions, if not. Okay, I'm gonna go on. This is another question. This is from Mark Williams. He asks, implicit in the memoir in terms of point of view is the I, not the first person as the I. As memoirists, how is the I perhaps both liberating and confining? Where in the context of the work, one's own positioning can obstruct seeing, or one's own positioning can obstruct context. More specifically, as Ms. Evans said, quote, I cannot name all the names, end quote, but the I is all of them? That's a question. Anyone? Bryn, do you want to take that?
Yeah, I can take it. Thank you, Mark, for your question. I think when I said that I cannot name all the names, and that is precisely the issue, I was mostly speaking to the idea that because there are so many names that do not go viral and do not get circulated, and that I just simply cannot have access to because of I am this only one person, it does lend itself to kind of like a very almost helpless mentality. But I think that the limitations, though there are limitations of the I think that listening is a form of liberation in that way, because by listening, I am able to have access to other eyes outside of myself. Mm-hmm. And even though those two will never become exactly, you know, the same, they'll come closer. And that closer, it reduces that tension in a way, which I think the tension of the public and private was mentioned in the prior question. And then to answer your question, just like say that part about poetry, I do think that tension between the public and private is there, because I was going to actually include some verses in this presentation, but I felt not necessarily irresponsible, but I personally, as a poet, like to provide explanations. I'm willing to provide explanations to some aspects of my work. And I felt like since I didn't necessarily have the time to do all that, it wouldn't be futile, but I would rather focus on the lyrical analysis than my own poetry. But yeah, I think there are tensions between the public and the private, but there are also tensions that exist within the public and within the private. So with poetry specifically, there are different aspects of myself that are also kind of like, I don't know, no one is, even though Black women, which is my identity that I express, we're not a monolith. People are also not monoliths in themselves. We change from day to day. And so I think, I don't know, I've come to realize that that tension should be embraced. And like I said, I feel like tension can somewhat be reduced by listening. Listening is a form of liberation.
Great, thank you. I'm just gonna follow up, and this is maybe asking for a quick answer, Bryn. There was a question from Amanda Agay, who asked about the selection of Solange's album that you shared. She says, it was a real source of deep healing for myself. How has the album influenced your sense of self and your mental health? If you could give us a quick answer, please, Bryn.
Very quickly, I think in my subtitle, this idea of self-articulation is something that Solange necessarily embraces. Even though she is a mainstream artist, I feel that she has kind of, in her work, I see this willingness to self-articulate and also to, you know, self-critique in a way that is very beautiful and has helped me with my own relationship to self. And then, I don't know, I see in a lot of her work futurity, and I think that's really necessary for me and my work because I'm constantly, you know, embracing these stories that can be violent and can be mournful. But this idea of futurity, of looking for one's glory, of looking for one's body, that this, you know, exists somewhere, is really helpful for me. So I can definitely relate to you in that sense.
Great, thank you. So now I have a question for Yelaine Rodriguez. This is from Nancy, who says, I'm really curious about your textile work. Could you speak more about how you bring your political and aesthetic interventions into your fashion, sewing, weaving art, and why this art medium is important to you?
Hi, thank you for your question. The weaving, I'm very interested in being like taking parts of every part of the piece. So I try to create my own textile. If I don't know how to sculpt, I'll teach myself or have other artists teach me how to do the mask. And I've been able to create these pieces even though I didn't study that in school. And the weaving, I went to a town in Oaxaca in Mexico so they can teach me how to dye with natural fibers. Because I really like to get involved into every aspect of the piece. But for the weaving, specifically, I try to think about, I always start with blue in connection to water. Mm-hmm. And I think about the ancestors that decided to jump off the boat instead of landing in their final destinations. So I try to use that to create the textile first, and then I go into browns to implement these like scars that are like the scars that we carry with ourselves through this journey and the generational trauma that is implemented there. And that is all woven into the piece because weaving for me is very therapeutic, and I feel like that lacks in our culture, in my community specifically, in the Dominican community, trying to find form of therapy. So I use the weaving as a form of therapy to process these narratives into the textile. And then I always try to implement imagery that also connects all the points. So Haiti, the Dominican Republic, and New York and the States. All these parts that are collaged together that are part of my identity. into one piece. Hope that I answered the question.
Yes, yes, of course you did. Okay, so there was another question. This is a question, I think, for everyone from Tennille Mack that says, I appreciate the acknowledgement of yourself within each of your disciplines. How has your research impacted how you all view your place and decisions you make in the world as Black women?
Gayatri, can you start with that answer?
No, I actually, if I may, just go back to the earlier question around the I, because I think that's really relevant to thinking about Sikandar. And in relation to Cheryl's gloss on what I presented, you know, I think the power of her work is that she pushes against the assumptions of what that I is. And I think we actually, linking to the current question, I think we're all doing that, you know, as feminist scholars, artists, activists of color, right, in the academy, we're constantly pushing against the assumptions, the presumptions that are coming at us from others. And I think with an artist like Sikandar, you know, she's pushing against specifically the idea of what is supposed to be work by female artists, Muslim women artists, artists from the global south. And I think she does that by actually pushing against the categories of gender in the first place. So I really appreciated Bryn bringing into our frame the lives, the bodies of trans femmes, because I actually think that, you know, what Sikandar is doing is pushing against the idea of what woman is in the first place, right? And really expanding and exploding those categories. So rather than seeing her simply through a more conventional feminist frame, I think what I'm trying to do is bring a kind of queer reading to this work that is usually not read through that lens. Thank you.
May I answer this question as well?
Yes, please do. Thank you, Destiny.
Of course. So I certainly think that this research process has completely transformed the way that I view my hometown. So I'm born and raised in Tampa, Florida, and one of the first things that many people learn about me is how much I love Tampa, Florida. But through this process and through the erasure that I kept running into and finding within our city's archives, within the major cultural institutions that I think, that I thought would hold this history and would maintain and preserve the history of Mildred Thompson's experience as the artist in residence, that erasure completely changed the way that I thought about this place. Also, of course, being able to lean into archival information from the Rose Library, also at Emory University, also information provided to me by Melissa Messina, and meeting and discovering people who knew Mildred personally while she was here, that whole experience really allowed me to find these places, to find where her studio was, to find where the new place was once located. And now that I know where they are, those places will never be the same for me. When I walk past them, when I drive past them, I'll know what stood there. And that has been so transformative to me as a person, to me as a Tampanian, but also to me as an artist and as a scholar. And so I intend to continue this work here in Tampa and also to move it to the other places where she was, notably back in Atlanta, Washington, D.C., and Germany, and in Paris, to see whether or not this process can sort of be replicated there and what I can discover using it.
Thank you so much, Destiny. And I'm going to close. We just have a very few minutes left. A question from Hannah Ryan for Dr. Gill. Could you talk more about this compelling phrasing that you closed with, that attention to these narratives emphasizes that Black living, and she has living all capitalized, matters? Also, your talk made me think about other African-American thinkers, writers, artists who had to leave the United States in order to find safer and more welcoming communities. And I guess we would include Mildred Thompson in that mix, in which to work. And I wondered if you or any of the other presenters would like to talk about that.
Sure, thank you so much for that question. I think this whole idea of Black living, sort of thinking about the hashtag and the movement of Black Lives Matter, but thinking more concretely about what living means, is a way for us to think about what is really at stake, right? I remember, and some of you may have seen this, there's been a video floating around from a comedian. I think it's Michael Che or something like that. And he talks about, you know, when we think about just the term Black Life Matters, how simple a request it is, right? Like how we're in a place of such despair over Black survival that we're literally just asking for Black life to matter. And so I started thinking about the women that I study and the folks that I study and the kind of work that I do, and even just thinking about what's at stake in this current iteration of the Black freedom struggle, but also the very long iteration, is that, you know, it's never just been about laws. It's never just been about mere survival. Those are the access points. But what these movements are about, and I think studying Black leisure really gets us to this, is about being able to live our Black lives in all of its fullness, right? And that means people making choices that we don't always agree with, et cetera, but just the freedom to be able individually and collectively to live the fullness of those lives. And so that was just something, particularly as I was steeped in these memoirs, and to connect to the last question, it really made me think about the conditions under which we do our work, right? So whether it is the folks that are writing these memoirs or producing art, just thinking about the impact of this particular historic moment that we're living in and how that impacts how we read back into our work, how we read the artist, how we understand and produce art, and being able to see within that, that they're not just asking for mere survival, but they're asking for much larger things and living in its fullest.
So I just want to thank you all today for your rich and very important contributions to this conversation. We're going to be continuing the conversation next week. I was going to say same bat time, same bat place, but next Wednesday at 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, other times around the world. You'll find a link at the NYU Washington Brademas Center for the conversation, which will be focusing on the work of artists next week. So once again, thank you all. Thank you, Tom McIntyre, for your production. Thank you all for joining us today, and we look forward to continuing the conversation. Take good care and be well.